picture first. I am a pain management specialist and I will tell you about how you can use yoga to help you if you have pain. Now pain, like somebody just said, that nobody likes pain. Pain is something that troubles them and disturbs their life. So you want to get rid of pain. But in my previous talks I have said that pain is very beneficial initially. But when it becomes chronic, after 2 months, 3 months, it becomes a useless pain. That is when pain should not be there. But if you have a fall, if you have a fracture, you need pain to tell you that you have damaged something. If you burn yourself, you need that pain to tell you. But after the fracture has healed, if you still have pain after 3 months, then that is a useless pain that needs to be addressed. So all pain is not bad. Some pains are very essential. After 6 weeks, we usually say pain is chronic. That is when you need to get rid of the pain. Now initially it was thought that there is a single pathway for pain. You get one nerve gets irritated and you feel pain. But now that whole concept has changed to something called as neuromatrix, where the brain is responsible for you perceiving pain. Okay, if you don't have a functional brain, you will not feel pain. If you have a functional brain, all these factors contribute to your pain. Your socio-cultural behavior. Some societies may pain is accepted, that certain pain is there, it is part and parcel of your life, so people don't complain. Some societies, slightest pain, they want immediate treatment. In India, we actually tolerate lot of pain. Many women here deliver without labor analgesia. Abroad, it will be unthinkable. Because here we tell that you need that pain. So those socio-cultural practices contribute to your perception of pain. Genetic. Some of the genes do cause excessive pain. Environmental factors, they contribute, psychological and behavioral. So all these contribute. So that is what is the neuromatrix. Okay. Now why this is important is because yoga addresses many of these. So that is why I have put this slide. So now chronic pain is considered to be a disease of the nervous system. It is a disease. It is not just a symptom. It is a whole disease. It destroys your central nervous system. So it is a complex procedure process involving the spinal cord and higher brain structures. Okay, if you don't understand anything, if you think it is too complicated, just stop me. Now because we have yoga, we have many other practices. A lot of people in the West are now turning to us, not just India, China, Japan, all these, we have certain practices which help us in tolerating and accepting pain in a better way. We do not have so many patients on morphine over there. For pain, they start morphine very early and they have lot of addiction problems, which here we still do not have, but we may have if we follow the West. So they are all now looking to the East and they have come out with something called as integrative medicine, where they are now integrating, means as part and parcel of treatment along with medicines, along with pharmacotherapy. Yoga, meditation, massage, all of that is added, and that is now called integrative medicine. So integrative medicine is now coming up in a big way in the US. The NIH, which is the National Institute of Health, is now looking at all this, and they are getting insurance also for this. Massage is now covered under insurance. Yoga is also, some yoga sessions for migraine, for fibromyalgia are covered under insurance. Fibromyalgia. So the most important reason to embrace this is the serious adverse effects of medication. If without medicines you can reduce pain, there is nothing like it. And yoga is something that has no side effects like medicines have. If you do it incorrectly, of course it can cause lot of problems, but if done correctly under a supervised teacher, then it is very beneficial. So this is a very recent 2015 article where the US Army General has said that you need to flip the therapeutic order. First they would start medicines, etc., etc. Last would be yoga, massage and all. And they say that you now begin with yoga, massage, chiropractic, acupuncture for back pain. So this is a huge shift from medicine to non-medical, non-pharmacological approach. Hardvaid, je apan mhanto te. They look at the alignment of the bones and they correct it. Spinal manipulations. Yeah. So yoga is actually a way of life. as we see it. It is not just asanas, it is not just postures. Yoga is a complete change in your behavior. It is, you have to begin your day, end your day, live your life in a certain disciplined manner. That is yoga. With our lifestyle, we are actually building up toxins, you know. If you see that everything in our body is carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, most of it. And when it is broken down, it is all a chemical reaction. All chemical reactions have some waste products. Even photosynthesis in the plants, oxygen is a waste product. So in our body, we have carbon dioxide and there are some free radicals which are released. These get oxidized by the oxygen we take in. When there is excessive free radicals, so when you eat stale food, stale meaning prepared very early, it becomes rancid, the oil becomes rancid. That produces free radicals. All the fast food, they all have lot of free radicals and this causes oxidative stress, meaning irritable bowel syndrome. All these are not diseases, they are lifestyle related problems. Acid reflux, no, psychosomatic. All those. I am talking of yoga. We can talk of yoga for prevention of pain. So before you get pain, so as a child, as a teenager, as an early adult, what if you follow yoga, there are certain beneficial aspects. When you have pain, how to deal with pain? Like the same surgery undergone by two people, both responses are not the same. One person may have excessive pain, one person may just take it as matter of fact, I don't have any problem. Same thing with everyday life, ups and downs. Some people don't get affected, some people get excessively affected. So yoga helps in coping with pain, reducing the severity of symptoms and overall wellness. So yoga is not a treatment. He just asked me, what can be cured? It cannot be cured. If diseases like malaria, you take anti-malarials, it is cured. You have pneumonia, you take antibiotic, your pneumonia goes away. But if you have wear and tear of your bones, that is not a disease. That is part and parcel of everyday this thing. So you can reduce the wear and tear. You can prevent early wear and tear, but you cannot stop it. It is part and parcel of aging. So it happens to everybody. Some people early, some people late. So if you want to reduce the wear and tear, you can try this. It is more of self-healing. So how you manage yourself, that is how where yoga does. And you have to do it consciousness. It is not that somebody is doing some asana, you do it and you should be okay. No. Concentrates and does that particular yogic posture or procedure, you get maximum benefit. You have to be fully aware of what you are doing.
One of the definition of yoga is union of body and mind.
Yes. It is coming. I will come to that. That is correct. It is when mind and body are in perfect harmony. If that harmony is not there, you will not get the beneficial effects. So in prevention, it improves resilience. Resilience means?
Capacity to withstand.
Correct, withstand some adverse event. So like now in India, if you see, we have had so many catastrophes. We had the Mumbai bomb blast, we had so many. But next day, we are all back on our feet. But in the US, if you see, they are still...
1 week, it was almost a month.
Yes, and still after so many years, they are paranoid.
Right.
So that way, we are more resilient because we are used to hardships. So our capacity to withstand is very good. And that is all because of our forefathers who were very disciplined. So I don't know if our children will be the same. But at least till now, we are a very resilient community. India is very resilient. Then... good practice of yoga improves the hypothalamo-pituitary circuit. Do you know hypothalamus?
No.
What they say is the third eye.
Third eye.
Huh. So right behind this is our hypothalamus, which from which most of our hormones are controlled and secreted. When you are stressed, it causes a complete disturbance of this whole rhythm. So with good yoga, it normalizes this, reduces the abnormal secretion and erratic secretion of the hormones. Then this is what they say, that when you are stressed or when you are having an unhealthy lifestyle or there is oxidative damage, your cells are not functioning normally. They are deprived of oxygen. So all the waste products which need to come out don't come out. They accumulate in the cell and that causes disease, which is what yoga says, that when prana is not proper, oxygenation is not proper, that is how you get disease, including cancer. That is what it is said, but it is to be proved now. But if you improve your oxygenation, if you breathe properly, it can improve the cellular oxygenation. So oxygen is very important, everybody knows that. And when we do pranayama, that is not only you control your breathing, but you also, if you see our lungs have a capacity of 1500 ml volume per, it is called as tidal volume, okay, but we don't take such a deep breath, we take very shallow breaths. So when you do deep breathing, there are dormant alveoli, one third of the lungs is just dormant, means blood is going but oxygen is not coming in because we are not deep breathing. We sit all the time, so the lower part of our lungs does not take part in ventilation, which is oxygen carbon dioxide exchange. So when you do this, then what happens, the lower part becomes higher. So that part is taking part in oxygenation. Yes, inverted asana mein. So you are engaging your dormant alveoli and you are opening it up and adding to it. Same thing. I don't know the name. This is a good posture. Okay.
Actually, there are other pranayams also.
There are a lot of pranayams.
I am a yoga teacher.
Okay. So you can tell them, you can teach them that. But this is how pranayam helps. That is one. That is, it recruits dormant alveoli. Second, when you do deep breathing, you are stretching your back muscles. Otherwise, when you're sitting like this in a slumped posture, your back muscles are stiff. So when you do deep breathing, you are actually elongating your spine and you are stretching it. You can add whenever something more is there. Now, as I said, when we sit for a long time, what happens is the whole body weight comes onto your dependent area. So your muscles get strained, compressed. When you don't get up for 5 hours, 6 hours, because of compression, there is compression of the capillaries or small blood vessels. Oxygen does not go inside. So the tissues lose their oxygenation and they become stiff over a period of time. If it is only for a few days, it is temporary stiffness, which with exercise goes away. But if you sit for years and years, like many office goers, they get a stiff back after some time. Those who work on the computer get neck problems and shoulder problems because same posture for a prolonged time. So now in all offices, they are told every half an hour you should change your position, get up, move around. Okay, so that is to improve the oxygenation of the tissues, prevent stiffness.
Also, yoga helps add flexibility.
Yes, because it prevents this stiffness.
So offices
also have standing desks. Yes, standing desks. Now they have removed their chairs. They don't sit only. That is, it had come in the paper also. Yeah. The Google CEO is now having a standing desk because of low back pain. Now Kapalbhati, like I told you, heartburn. We have an autonomic nervous system, sympathetic, parasympathetic. Sympathetic is related to stress, okay? So it increases gastric motility, causes diarrhea, and parasympathetic is a normalizing thing. When you do deep breathing, you are causing more of vagal or parasympathetic stimulation. Kapalbhati also does that. It actually harmonizes the upper abdominal viscera and your breathing airways, okay? So the forceful expiration that you do with Kapalbhati, it stimulates something called as the celiac plexus. The celiac plexus is there which supplies the pancreas, liver, spleen, all that. So it is very good for those with irritable bowel syndrome, okay? And according to yoga textbooks, it helps improves the vitality. Vitality means perfusion of abdominal organs, so that the acid reflux, the digestion problems, all that is reduced. So that is how yoga helps. And how it helps in pain is because of improved performance of the organs. Whatever food you are eating gets digested better. Vitamin B12 is produced in the stomach. Vitamin D is absorbed. So when your digestion is not good, these vitamins are not absorbed. Even if you are taking tablets weekly, your vitamin D is still low. So by doing this, you are improving the digestion, improving the uptake of all the vitamins from your food. It stimulates the pancreas. Okay, so all these are there. Improves posture, improves muscle flexibility. Because again, when you are doing this, your back muscles get stretched. You have to sit erect and do it. And when you are doing this, sitting erect and you are pushing your abdomen behind, your upper back muscles get stretched. So it is very good for your back muscles. Meditation. Now, as I told you, pain is perceived in the brain, and there are certain areas of the brain, like insular cortex is one, and meditation has shown to affect this, and this is very important in pain perception. So if meditation causes beneficial effects on this area of the brain, it also means that it reduces your pain perception. Pain is there, but you are not disturbed by the pain. Understand?
It interferes with it, or
it does not interfere. It helps you get detached. Manje, you may have pain, you may have a very tough time, you may be having low back pain, but the disturbance or the emotional distress that is caused is reduced. The ability to deal with it improves.
So it will be insulating the insular cortex itself?
Insulating nahi. Insular cortex is associated with emotional outbursts. So the agitation that you get, some people get agitated, I'm not sleeping well, I'm very irritated, they become short tempered, they have all these other problems in dealing with the pain. They are not able to deal with it. Like if you see, what example can I give you? In labor, supposing a labor, some people shout, some people are okay, they are having pain, but they don't shout. The same way in everyday life also, some people with pain are restless, they become agitated, they take medications, they just go to the chemist and buy some painkillers, keep popping pills, some people take alcohol, some people resort to some other thing. So the ability to deal with it is better when you meditate. You are more calmer, you take it in a more positive way rather than becoming negative. And the psychological aspects of trauma are also reduced. Okay, so this is all evidence. They have done research, they have done studies on patient population, and they have published this data that meditation helps in better behavior when they are doing this. Yoga Nidra. Yoga Nidra is conscious relaxation. Okay, have you done, anybody has done yoga nidra? Yeah. So when you do yoga nidra, you can actually feel your body become so heavy that you cannot even lift one finger when you do it in a correct way. And after doing yoga nidra, you will have no pain for that much time. It is so good. Now we have our own descending pathways. Descending pathways means from the brain they come down to the periphery, and these reduce our pain. Our body itself, see, sometimes a mosquito bites, after 5 minutes you forget it has bitten. The mosquito bite is still there, the redness is still there, but the pain goes away. Why does it go away? Because our body has our own pain reducing pathway. Over a period of time, when we are getting so much pain, we stop using our own pathways, or it is not functional. Some people do not use it. With yoga nidra, you are actually harnessing your own body's healing power. So that's why you can see all the yogis or those who do real tapasya and sadhana, they can actually go barefoot without clothes in cold temperatures, which we cannot do because we have not harnessed our inner strength so much. So those who do this regularly are able to do all this just because they are harnessing their own capacity.
And it regenerates your body and mind.
Yes.
Practice.
Yeah. So it is very good. All the muscle tensions at the end of the day get reduced. If you do this every day, we use our muscles, they become stiff, they become tired. But because we don't get enough sleep, or we are having a disturbed sleep, thoughts are there in our mind, our muscles don't get to relax. If you do yoga nidra, you can actually relax your body so much that you go to a level where It is like a self-hypnosis. You hypnotize yourself to become totally relaxed. You are conscious but totally relaxed. Now, the asanas. Asanas are one part of yoga. Yoga is not equal to asana. There are a lot of things to yoga. In the asanas, there is something called as kinetic chain. Our neck is not separate, chest is not separate, back is not separate. Everything is connected to each other. So if there is a problem in one part, the distal parts will get affected over a period of time. So this is called as kinetic chain. So Surya Namaskar is something that very nicely sees to it that this whole chain functions smoothly. So it is a good practice to do. There is lot of evidence. We talk of evidence-based medicine. If something has evidence, only then it is correct. So for yoga also in the West, there is evidence. In India, we have evidence. It is not accepted by the West. It is there in our Indian journal. Okay. So it modulates the stress response on the hypothalamo-pituitary axis and pain perception, which I have already mentioned. They found that in fibromyalgia, they have found good relief with that. Now, if you compare Chinese medicine and our own yoga, they also talk of meridians and certain points which are acupressure points. Yoga also corresponds to those. So what they have seen is that yoga postures directly press these key points along the meridians and it redirects the circulation of vital energy. Vital energy means oxygenation and blood flow. Okay, so it is very similar to the Chinese this thing. Massage, I told you this. In Ayurveda, they use herbs. We have still to study the herbs to find out the active ingredient, but it has proved to be very beneficial. So,
I would like to add something. Yoga also massages your internal organs.
Yes, it does. Very necessary. So, especially Kapalbhati.
Not
massage.
Yoga,
yeah, you can do them. Now, we have lymphatics. Lymphatics, you've heard of lymphatics?
Yeah. Parallel to the circulatory system.
Yes, there is another one, lymph, which removes the toxins. Okay, so if you see elephantiasis, there is lot of, because the lymphatics are blocked, the leg becomes like an elephant. So that is the amount of lymph produced. Okay, even after cancer, you can see somebody's hand becomes swollen. That is all because of blockage of lymphatics. So massage actually stimulates the lymphatics to remove the toxins. So massage helps for pain reduction. When you have pain and there is no contraindication, like supposing you have a fracture, you cannot do massage obviously. But if there is no contraindication, a massage in pain is very beneficial. Okay? Because it stimulates the lymphatics to remove all the toxins. So to summarize, yoga has so many benefits. Okay? And it reduces so many of the adverse effects. So if you have pain, yoga very helpful to you, provided you talk to your doctor that there is no contraindication. And even if you don't have pain, a regular practice of yoga will help you in dealing with pain, reducing the severity of your symptoms. So yoga is good for everybody at all ages, whether you have pain or not. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.